Mini Chapter 19, The Silver Lake Bar on Hyperion Avenue. Jaymi's first response to seeing Bangdead's new gal score, babe or gross newsfeed, was to start creating Evelyn's code out of thin air, beginning with nothing but a faint fore-echo of this beast's sunny, cool freedom. If the ones and zeros behave themselves, she will soon emerge from her code. She'll be painted with her own visuals, which will animate her. She'll be scored with her own soundtrack, which will come alive, and she'll be tested. Then, within a few days, she'll be electrified into incarnated form in all her beauty like a burst of love. But despite this creation cycle of Evelyn, there is little clarity as to how the gal score, babe or gross newsfeed could possibly fail to barrel upwards and outwards in popularity and profitability around the world, at least for as long as tabloid culture outsells the rest. There can be no assurance of the success of any investment, but a media stream that facilitates the rating of individual women for attractiveness, using Ain't They Freaky's Freakometer, from a highest score of 10 for babest down to a lowest score of 1 for grossest by members of the public, does at least start out with the benefit of appealing to the resources of a decent majority. Incarnated into the world by themselves, Jaymi's bursts of Evelyn love would stand no chance against such competition. But with a little backup from Amber, perhaps they might survive after all. For despite the disconcerting quality of his presence, the incarnated Amber does appear to be obedient to Jaymi's commands, and he did offer to deal with the dreary ones in whatever way his creator wished to see them squirm. In the brief time since his incarnation, Amber has taken up residence in the guest wing of the house on Electra Drive, keeping to himself with an unexpected and perhaps ominous quietness, as if awaiting orders. Ahead of Evelyn's incarnation, perhaps he should therefore be sent off on a discreet fact-finding mission into the lives of certain newsfeed-designing Bangdead employees to identify a few weak points in those employees' inhabitations of the world. Musing thus, Jaymi grins. Amber surely could identify each dreary one's unimpressive attributes, since he's pretty much an extension of Jamie's own vivid awareness of them. However, what should Amber then do with such newfound knowledge about Dud, Ashley, Kelly, and Herb? And Jamie's grin fades a little as he realizes he doesn't quite know the answer to this yet. Well, not to worry. Amber will know what to do when he meets them. This beast-wielding business is somewhat like driving through darkness, it seems. With the headlights illuminating only a short distance ahead, Jaymi must trust the whole journey can thereby be achieved without coming upon a sudden cliff edge. Still, he now has the basis of a plan for interacting beasts. But first, he himself should find out whatever he can from the dreary ones in person. He's not yet given them reason to believe he suspects them of the drone attack. It would still be plausible that Jaymi should think the drone attack was the work of someone else. If he contrives to bump into Dud, Ashley and Kelly soon, then he'll be able to do to them as he did to Herb, leave them thinking he attributes the attack to some rich kid with an expensive toy, or some would-be burglar. Good. Then he'll try to bump into each of those three in the next day or two, at one of the usual haunts. A quick exchange about his getting a wacky little visit from a drone, then a snippet of chit-chat, and they'll be reassured Jaymi doesn't yet know they have him in their sights, let alone want to target them back. The Silver Lake Bar, he murmurs aloud, and checks the time. It's funny, over the last few weeks, and in particular since he embarked on the creation cycle for a second beast, he has spent remarkably little time in any location other than this house on Electra Drive or the Melrose Avenue building. A casual observer would never have guessed it from watching Jaymi's isolated labours for the last month, but he does in fact possess a grand and somewhat dangerous social charm, which he was never shy of wielding in those prior months when he used to venture out of these two creative cubicles and socialise like a normal human being. It may be no bad thing to give himself a quick refresher on socialising, lest he become a complete hermit. An hour later, he parks on a side street, strolls a couple of blocks to Hyperion Avenue, and crosses a terrace covered in umbrella-shaded tables, populated by a late-afternoon crowd. Laptops and mobile devices gleam amid coffee cups and glasses. He steps through a doorway into a spacious bar full of chatter. As his eyes adjust to the shade, he scans the room for faces he knows. And yes, she's over there, as he hoped. The Silver Lake Bar, as everyone calls it, is a known gathering place for many in the consumer-facing half of the games industry, such as bloggers, journalists, marketers, and players. One such is Bangdead's Kelly, who often heads straight here from the Sunset Boulevard building after work, on her way home to downtown. She's sitting by herself at a table in the corner, wrapped in her tablet, as she sips at a boat-sized white coffee cup. Via several brief stop-and-chats at intervening tables, Jaymi navigates towards her. Kelly, how's it going? Hey, Jaymi. Good, thanks. You good? Sure, can't complain. I just dropped by for some peace and quiet and privacy, but some hopes, right? I hear you. It's so noisy I can't even hear myself think. Mind if I join you for a quick coffee if you're not too busy? Sure, someone's coming to meet me in half an hour, but we're good till then. What's going on with you these days? And they're off. Smiling, they exchange a few items of bland news each, including Jamie's casual mention of a drone that recently flew up to his very own terrace. Some pesky would-be burglars, no doubt. Her mouth falls open. No way! Did you report it to the cops? Ah, no. Come to think of it, probably wasn't even burglars. More likely some rich kid who's just been given an expensive new tie. What will they think of next, eh? Now to steer her into verifying her home location, as he did with Herb. It's pretty peaceful, though, Mount Olympus. Oh, yes, I remember you moved there not long before you left us, she says. How is the new place? It's pretty good, thanks. Great views. You still in that same loft downtown? Yeah, I'm not giving that one up. Though the 101 does change from a freeway to a parking lot in the rush hour. Well, that was almost as easy as verifying Herb's home address was. On the table beside that big cup of hers, he sees coloured message bubbles popping up every few seconds on games-themed chat apps, forums and blogs, all sitting open on an array of tabs displayed on her tablet alongside general social media channels. Certain of those bubbles probably originate from other tables in this very bar, as she'll be aware of in some such cases, and unaware of in others. But most of them are floating in from, where? Well, who knows? From portable devices held in hands or laid on laps all across the land, on California beaches, in cars stuck on freeways, on lounging chairs beside outdoor swimming pools up in the Hollywood Hills, and in every kind of suburban bedroom, hundreds or thousands of miles away across multiple time zones. Running through and between these coloured bubbles of text and graphics, and powering them, are ruthless but fluid hierarchies of professional and amateur identities, always changing, yet maintaining that nebulous plexus of perceived qualities and social standing that characterises any contained online community. In this case, celebrated and ranked according to known benchmarks of dexterity and cleverness in familiar games, and shot through with raucous voltages of apishness and stupidity, affection and humour, malice and contempt, and charges of energy, both fizzing and lazy. Talking of neighbourhoods, where did you grow up, by the way, he asks her. I don't believe I ever knew. Highland Park, Detroit. Poverty and deprivation. Escaped as soon as I could, then worked my butt off to break into the industry. You know the last part of the story. Hearing this, Jaymi feels his own hidden enmity towards her softening a little, despite her being the leading visual designer on Ain't They Freaky, now trumpeting its brand new Gal Score, Babe or Gross newsfeed. A newsfeed whose flavour he can still recall so vividly from no more than that unique half-minute during which he could bear to look at it before turning his head away forever, and his nascent softening towards Kelly comes to an abrupt end. Amber will still be visiting her. It occurs to Jaymi that it may perhaps be interesting to ask her whether she herself happens to like Bangdead's new newsfeed. He's half aware that if her answer to this question turns out to be yes, he will have the option of first pointing out a few of that newsfeed's specific qualities and likely effects, and then inviting her to offer a word or two in elaboration of how those qualities and effects square with her liking it. His close-up view of her shallow grinning eyes, however, is such that it takes him only a few more moments to abandon this potential line of questioning.